In this video, we're going to look at the logistic equation, which is a really famous and useful differential equation. Specifically, it's what we call an autonomous differential equation. Basically, what that means is that my differential equation does not contain any t's or whatever your independent variable may be. So if I look at this right-hand side, I only have p, and then some constants r and k. So no t's there. So autonomous. And that'll make a difference when we actually start to sketch the direction field for this differential equation. But anyway, the logistic equation, really famous, really useful. It's usually used to model the way a population changes with time, right? So dp dt, here p represents the population of animals, of cells, whatever, and we're given an expression that describes the way it changes with time. And this is the general form of the logistic equation, rp times a quantity 1 minus p over k. Now here r is going to represent our growth rate, and then k is going to be something called the carrying capacity. And we'll actually talk about that a little more later. When we look at a specific example. But this is the logistic equation in general. So now let's look at a specific example. So here we're told, let the rate of change of the population of rabbits in a park be given by dp dt equals 0.4p times 1 minus p over 200. And then we're asked to do several things. To sketch the direction field, to sketch solution curves for various initial conditions, and then define the limit as t goes to infinity of p of t. Okay, so we want to sketch the direction field for this differential equation. Now, I mentioned just a second ago that this is what's called an autonomous differential equation, and there are certain steps you can follow to make sketching the direction field for an autonomous differential equation pretty straightforward. So those are the steps we're going to use in this problem. So let's go ahead and get started with sketching that direction field. So remember, when we sketch a direction field, basically what we're doing is we're going to be drawing the slope of p, our unknown function p of t. We're going to be drawing its slope at various points on this pt plane. And the way we're going to get those slopes is by evaluating dp dt at different points. Okay, so how do we do this for an autonomous differential equation? Well, the first step is to find the p-values for which this expression equals 0. So I want to solve 0.4p times 1 minus p over 200 equals 0 for p. Okay, so if I do that, I'm simply going to take 0.4p equals 0, and then 1 minus p over 200 equals 0. So I get solutions of p equals 0, and if you work this out, p equals 200. Now these are actually what we call equilibrium solutions. So how is this actually going to look on our direction field? Well, remember that our differential equation here is independent of t. That's going to make this really easy to graph, because I'm not going to have any change in the t direction. My slopes are only going to change in the p direction. So what I've just discovered by solving dp dt equals 0 is I found the p-values for which I'm going to have horizontal slopes. Okay, so let me sketch this in on the graph. So along the line p equals 0, I should have a series of little horizontal line segments. Okay, and once again, they're not changing in the t-direction because this differential equation is independent of t. And then the same thing along this line, p equals 200. I should have these little horizontal line segments. And these are what we call equilibrium solutions. And I'll explain that a little further in just a minute when we get to part B, when we sketch the solution curves. So hold that thought for just a second, those equilibrium solutions. Okay, so what's the next step? We're going to actually do steps 2 and 3 together. And these are going to be defined where dp dt is positive and where it's negative. Now, the easiest way to figure this out is just by setting up a number line. Okay, so I'm going to look at the sine of dp dt for various p values. Okay, so I know that p is 0 at, or that, sorry, dp dt is 0 for p equals 0 and p equals 200. So those values are going to kind of partition my number line. Now, I don't care about populations less than 0. So basically, I'm going to check the interval between 0 and 200, and then greater than 200, and see what the sine of dp dt is in those on those intervals. So for between 0 and 200, we could pick 100, for example. So once again, my differential equation is 0.4p times 1 minus p over 200. And I'm checking the sine of this for p equals 100. And I don't care about the value, I just care about the sine. Okay, so if I plug in 100, 0.4 times 100 is definitely positive. And then 1 minus 100 over 200 is positive as well. So I have a positive times a positive. So that's going to give me positive overall. And then what about for values greater than 200? So we could use, for example, 300 as a test point. Well, 0.4 times 300 is still positive. But 1 minus 300 over 200 is negative. Okay, so positive times a negative is negative overall. Okay, so I know then that dp dt is positive for p's between 0 and 200 and negative for p's greater than 200. So what is that going to translate to on my direction field? Well, between p equals 0 and p equals 200, I should have all positive slopes. And for p's greater than 200, I should have all negative slopes. And then remember, once again, I'm only ever going to change my slope in the p direction, never in the t direction. So I should always have these horizontal lines where the slope is the same along that horizontal line. Okay, so between 0 and 200, it should be positive. But that doesn't give me a ton of detail because, you know, what's the magnitude of the slope? Is it bigger? Is it smaller? I mean, it's definitely positive, but how big? So if we want to add a little extra detail to our direction field, what can be helpful is actually looking at the graph of this expression. So actually looking at the graph of 0.4p times 1 minus p over 200. Okay, so I'm going to just add that graph in here for us for just a second so we can look at it, and that'll help us draw our direction field. So what I've done here is I've simply graphed the function 0.4p times 1 minus p over 200. And I'm looking at that function here. So we should see some of the features we've already discovered here. And we do. We see that this is 0 at 0 and at 200. Okay, so that's good. And then we see that it's positive in between 0 and 200. That's what we said before, right? Positive here. And then it's negative for values of p greater than 200. Okay, so what we've discovered so far seems to be on track. But what this can do is this can give us a little more detail about the actual values of the slope. So let's look specifically at between p equals 0 and p equals 200. So this part of the parabola, right? This is a parabola. That makes sense because if I expanded this expression, I'd get a p squared. So this downward facing parabola. So between p equals 0 and p equals 200, it's positive. And what's happening is it's increasing And it looks like it reaches its maximum about 100, and then it's decreasing, right? But once again, positive the whole time. So how could we translate that into slopes in our direction field? Well, my slopes between 0 and 200 are going to be positive, but their magnitude is going to be greatest at 100. Okay, so maybe I want to start out with pretty mild flat slopes. Right, they're positive, but they're not very steep. And once again, I just go the same all the way across the horizontal line. But then maybe I want to make them just gradually a little bit steeper until I get to 100, where they're going to be the steepest. And then after that, I will kind of level back out again. And this is just a sketch, right? So you're just getting an idea of the behavior. So I'll just fill the rest of this in for us real quick. Okay, so something like this. So now let's think about what's happening for p-values greater than 200. Well, we know that our slope should be negative, but let's go back to our graph of the function to get a little bit more detail. Okay, well, I know this is a parabola, and here's 200, and so then for p-values greater than 200, I see that it's indeed negative, and basically what's going to happen is this is just going to get more and more negative, right? Larger and larger values in the negative direction. So then what should be happening on my direction field is that as I get above 200, my slope should be steeper and steeper in the negative direction. Okay, so maybe I start out with just a barely negative slope, but then as I go on, those are going to get steeper and steeper as p increases. So perhaps something like this. And my picture isn't perfect here, but these should be the same slopes along any given horizontal line, since once again, this is independent of t. Okay, so we have a sketch of the direction field. So then let's go on to part B, which is to sketch a few solution curves for various initial conditions. Okay, so what do I mean by initial conditions? So initial condition is, for example, P of 0 equals 0, or P of 0 equals 200, or maybe P of 0 equals 100, or maybe P of 0 equals 250. So all these notations mean so the population at time 0 equals something. So these are just giving me the initial conditions of the population, so my starting point for the population. And then based on that initial condition, there's going to be a certain trajectory of the population. And that's what we're going to try to sketch in. So let's do the ones I've listed here. So let's start with P of 0 equals 0. Okay, so my initial condition is 0 rabbits in the park. And based on the flow of my direction field, I want to sketch what the population would do from that point. So what would the solution curve be? Well, here I'm along what we call these equilibrium solutions, and we said we would talk about this a little bit more. So if I'm starting here at p equals 0, and I'm following these slopes, I'm just going to be stuck along this line, right? Since these are all horizontal slopes, I can't really go anywhere. That's why it's called an equilibrium solution. And this sort of makes sense intuitively. If you start with 0 rabbits, how are you going to get more rabbits? Right? There's no rabbits to have baby rabbits, so you're just stuck. Okay, so equilibrium solution. Okay, and then P of 0 equals 200, if I take that initial condition here, starting with a population of 200, I'm also along another equilibrium solution. Okay, so I'm just kind of stuck with 200 rabbits. Okay, but let's see what might happen for some different initial conditions that aren't along equilibrium solutions. Well, let's try P of 0 equals 100. So I'm starting with 100 rabbits, and I want to know what happens from there. Okay, well, I'm just going to try to sort of follow this flow as best as I can. So it looks like I'm starting to go up, and I'm pretty steep. Remember, 100 here is this where the steepest positive slopes are. And then I'm still increasing, but I'm kind of leveling off. And I'm leveling off, leveling off, leveling off. And it looks like if I had drawn some more lines, I would approach this equilibrium solution at 200. Okay, so let's actually do one more, maybe like at 150. So here I'm going to have kind of the same scenario. I'm going to be increasing. And then I'm going to keep increasing but sort of level off as I approach population of 200. What about P of 0 equals 250? So now I'm starting out up here above this equilibrium solution, so maybe somewhere right here. So here I have negative slope, so my solution should be decreasing, and it's decreasing more steeply at first, but then once again, it levels out and approaches this equilibrium solution. So what do I see here? It seems that no matter what population I start with, besides 0 and 200, right, those are my equilibrium solutions, but any other population I start with, I can see that it's going to approach this equilibrium solution of P equals 200. And that's actually the answer to part C. Find the limit as t goes to infinity of the population. So basically, as time goes on, what is the population approaching? That's what it's asking. And it's actually approaching 200 rabbits. So if the initial population is less than 200, as long as it's not 0, it's going to increase to 200. And if the population is greater than 200, it's going to decrease to 200. So that's why this, remember when we talked about the logistic equation in general, we had this K and we said it was the carrying capacity. And that's actually the part that 200 plays here. If I look at my equation, 200 is that carrying capacity. And basically, that's, you can kind of think about that as the population that the environment will support. So if there's less than that carrying capacity, the population can grow. But if there's more, there's just not enough resources to support the population, and the population will decline until it approaches that carrying capacity. Okay, so important things in this video are, one, just in general, sketching the direction field for an autonomous differential equation. So we use these steps where we figure out where the slopes are 0 and where the slopes are positive and negative. And remember, it's nice because it's independent of t. So that's one thing. And then also just understanding the logistic equation and that behavior is an important thing here as well.